this is nothing but going to be responsible for your related with of eye here. So any abnormality in the eye, we can able to see any fundus, we can able to see with it of your ophthalmoscope. And torchlight is going to be used for seeing for pupillary reflex. Next, coming on to the Snell chart. Here, Snell chart is going to be playing an important role to identify the refractory errors and refractory errors of the patient. Next, cotton swab is going to be concerned with it of your touch sensation. Tongue blades and tongue depressor are going to be helpful for identifying and seeing any pathology in the pharyngeal wall, backside of your tongue. So when you are going to give tongue depressor down, we can able to visualize all the structures of the pharynx there inside. Next, coming on to the safety pin is coming for your pain. So here, cotton is going to be concerned with it of light touch, and safety pin is going to be used for your pain sensation here. So these are the general instrument what we are going to use. Next, coffee powder is going to be of generally we are using for smell for identifying the olfactory nerve. These are the general instrument what you are going to use for general CNS abnormalities. One is reflex hammer, second is tunic fork, third is ophthalmoscope, Snell eye chart, cotton swabs, tongue blades, safety pin. Coming on to the tunic fork here, we are using three frequencies as I have given. So 256 megahertz is going to be useful for hearing abnormality, and 128 and 512 is going to test for vibration senses. Slide is changing?
Yes, sir. It's changing, sir.
Okay. Okay. Now, coming to the directly to the components of neurological examination. So, these are the main components useful for neurological examination here. So, neurological examination, as I implies, any problem in the nerve, we can able to do by examination and we can able to find out there. So, that includes one is mental status examination, cranial nerve, motor nerve, reflexes, sensory system, coordination, station and gait. So mental status examination is nothing but we want to identify the status of the mind of the patient by asking few questions, and we are going to do for. Cranial nerve examination is there, as we know that we are having 12 pairs of cranial nerves. So each and every cranial nerve, when it's going to be a normal, that is going to be assessed by some examination. Motor system assessment is nothing but, so motor, I told you, it's concerned with of your muscle there. So any abnormality in the muscle, we can able to identify with the top this examination. So muscle, then reflexes. Reflexes, I told you already, we are having two types of reflexes. One is superficial reflex, one is deep reflex. Again, reflex is one terminology where it is nothing but your afferent pathway. Afferent is that what I told you. So from the periphery towards the center. So sensory system and reflexes both are going to be afferent. So any abnormality is that by doing this test, we can able to test that this particular afferent pathway is going to be of clear or what. Next, coming on to the coordination. Coordination is that what we are thinking, what we are doing, both must want to be of equal. That is going to be of normal. So when anything is mismatching in what we are thinking and what we are doing, that will indicate abnormality. So that is the test what we are going to do for coordination. So we are going to ask something to do by the patient. Anything is going to be incooperated. So that indicates some abnormality in the patient. Next, station and gait. Gait is nothing but method of walking. So this method of walking also will be giving some indication what is the neurological examination. So these are the, I told you, and examinations consist of inspection, palpation, percussion, auscultation, along with the general examination. Here also, again, after that, here these are the main components where we are going to examine as mental examination, cranial, motor, reflexes, sensory, coordination, station and gait. This is the mental status examination. I want to give you an explanation. So coming on to the mental status examination, I told you previously, we are going to examine the mental state of the patient. So mental state is nothing but one, patient is conscious or what. Second, the patient is attentive or what. Third, patient is oriented towards or what. Fourth, patient is going to be of normally speaking and using normal languages as what. 5 memory. Patient's memory is correct or what? Lastly comes your higher intellectual. That is higher intellectual is there nothing but your sixth sense. We can able to identify intellect. We are applying by intellect or what? Try to differentiate which is good or bad. So when this everything is going to be a normal, patient is considered as normal. So when this anything is going to be defective, according to that, we are not telling that is known as abnormal patient. We are going to grade according to the pathology what it can present with inside. This is the level of consciousness what we are going to do. These are the important terminology. We want to think of consciousness. So I have given you normal in second quarter. So when patient is consciousness, we are putting as normal and we are leaving as is. We are telling the consciousness. So one terminology about to this metaconsciousness is that patient will have complete awareness of this surrounding. Usually when we are going to do some normal work, we are not concentrating on the surroundings here. But that metaconscious patient will be having complete awareness of the complete surrounding awareness. So that patient we are going to group under metaconsciousness. So that we are going to consider that preternatural, and it is known as one abnormal variety we can think of. Down to that we are putting as confused, delirious, somnolent, abundant, stuporous, coma. So again one terminology is confused. Confused is nothing but disorientation. I told you orientation is nothing but you want to get oriented with what you are going to leave here. So when I am going to leave one particular area, means I must want to adapt to the particular thing. So when this adaptation is not going to be of with what we are thinking, what we are doing, that is known as disorientation. So that is known as impaired thinking or responses. Coming on to the delirium, disorientation is there. Here, in case of confusionlessness, disorientation alone will be there. But in case of delirium, patient will be having more restlessness, more hallucination, and sometimes delusion. So hallucination, delusion is again a two terminologies where patient is going to be having abnormal visual communication by him. So they will be feeling abnormal images in front of him along with that restlessness symptom. So this, when patient is going to be having disorientation and with this hallucination delusion symptom, we are putting under grade of delirious features. Next, somnolence is there. As you know, somnolence is nothing but sleeping. So patient will be having so much drowsy like anything, he'll be always sleepy. That patient we are putting under sleepy variety. Next, abundant is going to be a one variety like reduced alertness, slower psychomotor responses. So in first terminology, we are telling that metaconsciousness, patient will be having complete awareness. So abundant is going to be having reduced alertness and psychomotor activity is going to be of reduced here. Next, last two is going to be of so important. Stuporous and coma. So coma patient is nothing but they will not have anything there, full nil. When we are giving stimulus also, nothing is going to be done there. But in case of nothing, when we are going to give pain, any pressure, patient cannot able to identify anything. But in case of stupor, patients will be of unconsciousness when they will be responding to painful stimuli. This is the differentiation between the two. So stupor is nothing but comatose patient will be having activity with slight painful stimuli they will be responding for. Comatose patient, nothing will be there for that patient. This is a differentiation between the comas and stupor. Here I want to tell you again, this I told you level of consciousness. Here Glasgow coma scale is going to be a one scale to differentiate, because I told you already patient will be having no response. So this is the total scale for scaling the coma patient to identify. Down you see minor brain injury, moderate brain injury, and severe brain injury. So we want to consider which variety of brain injury patient is having. So we want to go for. So here eye opening responses consist of 4, 3, 2, 1 points. See, first patient is going to be a all first symptom is going to be of normal. When it is coming reducing there, it indicates the more severity. So when patient is having opening normally, spontaneously, it is considered as normal. Then down, when patient eyes are open to verbal command, this is going to be a subabnormality. Then patient is going to be of open to pain, it is going to go for less more severe. not opening, going to be of so severe. So this is the gradation starting from up to down. So we are having three components. One is IE, one is verbal verbal response, third is motor response. So I you know that it is eye activity. Verbal is concerned with your speech. Motor response, I told you, is nothing but your voluntary movement activity. So patient moving normally, spontaneously, it is considered as 4. Verbal command, 3. To pain, 2. No opening, 1. So this is the thing, gradation, like that verbal. When you are going to speak, when patient is going to be oriented, 5. Confused, 4. Inappropriate responses, 3. Then sounds and speech alone is coming to no speech at all, that is going to be coming as 1. Motor responses, when we are going to obey commands for the movement. So when you are going to ask the patient to lift the hand, patient must want to lift. If patient is not lifting, so when patient is lifting, we are going to give as 6 points. So when instead of lifting there, when movement, unpurposeful movement is there with due to painful stimuli, 5. Withdraws when pain, when you are going to give pain, patient is withdrawing, that alone is there. Patient is not responding, that is coming as 4th point. Next, abnormal flexion. 3rd, extensor response is going to be of 2. No motor response is going to be of 1. So this is the general criteria to assess one patient of unconscious patient or coma patient. So as I told you, when 13 to 15 is there, that indicates minimum. Another thing, 9 to 12, it indicates moderate. And in case of patients having 3 to 8 points alone, that indicates it is going to go for severe brain injury. This is a thing of classification or grading of the unconscious patient. This is the main 3 etiology. They are giving that what may be the alteration due to loss of consciousness, level of consciousness. So level of consciousness may be there due to 3 reasons. One is that any abnormality in the chemical environment, that is anything is going to be of concern with alteration, poison or intoxication. Second, inefficient oxygen or blood flow in the brain was we told already. Next, excessive pressure within the skull, as I told you already, is nothing but your space occupying lesion abnormalities. When these 3 things are more predominant, it indicates that it can give rise to level of consciousness according to the severity of pathology. When there is going to be a more excessive pressure, it will be giving more level of unconsciousness. When there is going to be a more reduced blood flow, it will be giving same like that. More intoxication, it gives more pathology, more altered consciousness in this grade. It can go with metaconsciousness to comatose patient along the severity of the pathology there inside. This is concerned with the level of consciousness. Next, coming to the attention. We are going to take the second part of the mental status examination. First, level of consciousness finished. Next, attention finished. Attention, now we are starting with. So attention is that when consciousness awareness is focused on one thing, that is known as attention. So when we are going to concentrate on something constantly, we are going to put up attention. Attention we are going to grade into different things. One is known as selective attention, is that we are going to focus on one single thing alone, we are going to put up as selective attention. So when we are going to play, we cannot be able to play anything about playing, but I can, when I'm going to play or concentrate on mobile or outside, I cannot be able to concentrate on other things because I must want to win. So patient will be concentrating on one thing. Second variety is that divided variety is that multiple tasks they will be doing. While I'm working with laptop, I can able to hear some music. Or some students, what they will do, they will be doing their project work or writing assignments. They'll be putting some music there along with the hearing, they will go for. So some 2 things can able to do. Same like that for working housemates, mothers, what they will do while cooking also, they will put some music and they will do. Sometimes they will be singing also. So this is the variety where we are going to give divided variety of attention. So 2 or multiple tasks they'll be doing at a time. So selective is that by single, divided is by multiple tasks. Third, sustained variety, executive variety. These are the main 4 varieties of your attention. One is selective variety for single. Second is known as divided. Patient will be having divided variety, multiple tasks they can able to do. So sustained is that So patient, when they are going to put up under one thing, they must want to concentrate more time on that particular task alone. That is known as sustained, retained. So retained variety is known as another variety of attention, where to differentiate between schizophrenia patient, where patient cannot able to do this method of attention. So for this, this test, it will be helpful for you. Next, lastly, is nothing but executive test. Executive attention. Executive attention is nothing but, so all the thoughts, emotion, responses are going to be of correlated, and we'll be thinking and we'll be keeping as a nutshell there. So this is when we are going to ask stories, patient must want to tell everything by attention. So that is going to be affected in case of your anterior cingulate cortex and prefrontal structure abnormality. In that, patient cannot be able to give attention more than one or two. So these are the important points for your attention abnormality. Next, orientation. So as here we completed level of consciousness, next attention finish, next orientation. So orientation is, what is the definition of orientation? Is nothing but, so it is the thing of awareness of three dimension. When patient is going to be oriented with time, place, person, so that patient is considered as oriented. Oriented is nothing but one individual will be there. This individual, when he is going to be adapting with the surrounding environment like time, place, person, that is known as orientation. So altered orientation or disorientation may be due to, again, delirium and intoxication, or toxicity of the central nervous system, or depressed level of consciousness. When level of consciousness will be reduced, that also will be associated with orientation, I told you previously. Then in case of seizures, agitation, confusion, psychosis, everything, patient will be having altered orientation. So in this condition, to rule out that, we must want to ask some questions to the patient. What is the time now? Which place you are? So what is, who are you? Who am I? Like that, we must want to ask some questions, and we must want to confirm that patient is having orientation as what. So when this is going to be a normal, then patient is going to be considered as oriented. When anything is alteration is there, we must want to put up under disoriented state of the patient. Coming out of speech again. So already I told you, speech is consists of two. One is going to be central, peripheral. So dysphonia, dysarthria, two terminologies. Again, I am going to give you. So phonia means method of speaking. Phonia is nothing but sound produced. That is known as phonia. Arthria is nothing but articulation. So phonia is nothing but sound speaking. Which is the sound box? We are telling that vocal cord is going to be, we have a sound box. So any abnormality in the vocal cord, we are telling that abnormality in the speech. That, so that reduced voice is going to be produced. So that is going to be up there. So already I told you, one nerve is going to be mainly involved. That is known as recurrent laryngeal nerve. So when this recurrent laryngeal nerve is going to be a problem, so we can able to have vocal cord paresis. One. Second, any tumor in the vocal cord also can cause paresis. So these are the two important things. Patient will have dysphonia. This is nothing but abnormal tone, abnormal voice. Next, dysphonia and hypophonia is nothing but one condition known as Parkinson's disease. So Parkinson's disease, I will give you one rough outline. Parkinson's disease is known as one disease where one, it is going to be having extra pyramidal system involvement like thalamus, putamen, caudate nucleus. Second is that this is having dopamine abnormality. So two important, due to this two abnormality, patient will be presenting symptoms like outside. So this, in that, patient will be having dysphonia and hypophonia also. So that is the importance of phonia. Next, coming on to the arthria. Arthria, I told you, due to articulation. Articulation is concerned with that of your tongue, pharyngeal muscles, two things. So any problem in the pharyngeal, and sometimes they are telling that facial muscles also helpful for your dysarthria. So because facial muscles mainly is going to go for your facial expression. When there is abnormality in assisting for speech also, due to some facial muscle abnormality, we can able to have dysarthria. So dysarthria, spastic dysarthria, pharyngeal and facial muscle abnormality, we can have able to have one terminology known as spastic dysarthria. Next, cerebellar dysarthria. Cerebellar dysarthria is nothing but dysarthria due to any cerebellar abnormality. So cerebellum, when there's going to be of abnormal, not functioning, that will be causing of alteration of the speech. Nystagmus. Nystagmus is nothing but oscillatory movement of the pupils or eyes. Next, other movement, eye movement disorder, ataxia. Great ataxia means nothing but patient will be walking improperly. So 1, 2, 3. Nystagmus will be there. Eye movement will be there, along with gait ataxia, along with that of dysarthria is there for one patient. We can think of that may be of due to cerebellar abnormality. When there is no nystagmus, no abnormality in the gait, we can rule out that cerebellum may not be involved in this patient. Next, I told you Parkinson's disease. So Parkinson's disease is known as hypokinetic. Hypo means reduced speaking. So Parkinson's, we are having triad of three. One is rigidity, tremor, bradykinesia. So patient will be having more rigidity, patient will have more tremor, and bradykinesia, all the activities will be of so reduced like anything. Slow movement patient will be having. So that patient will be having dysphonia and dysarthria patient will be having. Patient will be having symptoms like stammering speech. That is going to be another feature of Parkinson's disease. Next, coming on to the flaccid dysarthria, which will be there in the bulbar palsy. So bulbar is related to your medulla oblongata. So that is nothing but 7th and 12th nerve is arising from your pons and medulla. So any abnormality in the medulla can cause dysarthria and dysphagia, can cause palatal weakness. Palatal weakness is nothing but your uvula. We are having two things. One is soft palate, hard palate. Hard palate is nothing but a partition between your nose and the mouth. Soft palate is nothing but what is hanging out behind is your uvula. So any palatal weakness, when it's going to be causing due to this 7th and 12th nerve, can cause abnormality. So 12th nerve is concerned with of your tongue. 7th nerve is concerned with of your facial expression. So any abnormality in the 7th and 12th nerve can cause dysarthria. Next, myasthenia gravis and polyneuropathy also we can able to have dysarthria. So these are the varieties what I want to tell you. So myasthenia gravis, I want to tell you here. So main pathology is there in myasthenia gravis is nothing but receptor defect for acetylcholine. So defect will be there in the acetylcholine receptors. So that patient cannot able to use the acetylcholine. So contraction abnormality patient can have. So that patient will have weakness. That is the differentiating between your Parkinson's. Parkinson's patient will have dopamine abnormality. Here, patient is having acetylcholine abnormality. Acetylcholine abnormality is nothing but excitatory. Dopamine nothing but inhibitor. So this is the differentiating between the Parkinson's and myasthenia gravis here. Next, polyneuropathies. Polyneuropathies, as you know, any nerve abnormality. Next component I want to tell you is that memory. So memory is concerned with that of four. One is registration, immediate, recent, remote. So what and all we are thinking, what and all speaking must want to registered first in your brain. Then immediately you must want to recall. Then immediately if you are recalling, that is normal. Then some recent activity happened 2 hours or 3 hours or half a day before, you want to recall. Then lastly is that past events. When these four components are normal, your memory is considered as normal. One is registration. Registration is nothing but so what you are going to teach them, some repeat some words. Immediately we want to tell some words like apple, tables or some words and ask the patient to tell within 2 seconds or 3 seconds. So your input is normal, registration is normal, patient is repeating. So that registration part of your patient's body is normal, we can think of. So any defect in repeating, there itself we can identify that registration part of the patient is going to be affected. So this is the first test what we are going to do. Next thing is that immediate recall. So we must want to give something, words to remember after 5 minutes, example for 1 to 3 minutes after, like is in memory. So breakfast, what is going to the patient? When patient is not there, again memory next level will be going. Next is remote memory. So where, hello? Next, where did you go to school? Another thing, past events when you are going to see, that will be giving us abnormality there. So when patient is failing in the registration, that is known as more dangerous. When patient is losing remote, is that less dangerous? We can able to think of according to the grading of memory in each and every patient here. Then here comes last higher intellectual function. So higher intellectual function, when this is the thing of mental examination. So intellect of the patient, intellect is that reasoning. So how the patient can able to use higher senses. So this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This consists of 4 points. One is 5 points. One is general knowledge, abstraction, judgment, insight, reasoning. So general knowledge is that any general knowledge question like that. Who is president of Missouri, or which is capital of Illinois? Illinois is nothing but one state in the US. Like that, we can able to ask more general knowledge question, and we can assess that grade of the patient. Another thing, abstraction is that dealing with some ideas. So when we are going to throw stone on the glass houses, what will happen? So what is your idea? So we can ask like this question, and we can able to ask some answers from the patient. Like that, we can able to go for. Next, judgment. Judgment comes of three. What do you have when you are going to feel, when address envelope is there, what you will think of, what may be there inside, what you will think of, like that, we can able to ask to the patient. Next, insight is that, what is the actual reason for doing? Why my daughter is bringing to my hospital, like that? Why did your hospital daughter bring to your hospital? Like that, patient is identifying or what? To identify the insight. Reasoning is like thing, but to differentiate between lie and mistake. Lie is that what we are knowing and doing. Mistake is that unknowingly doing. That thing patient must want to differentiate between. So this thing patient can able to do or what we want to test that. This is the simple example I have given you to test for each and every patient to examine for higher intellectual function. So this completes the mental status examination of the patient. Now going proper to the cranial nerve examination, as you all know, we are having 12 cranial nerves. One is olfactory, optic, oculomotor, trochlear, trigeminal, abducens, facial, vestibulocochlear, glossopharyngeal, vagus, accessory, and hypoglossal. So here, olfactory nerve is concerned with the smell. Second, optic is concerned with the vision. Third, oculomotor is concerned with the eyeball muscles. Fourth, trochlear, I told you, trochlear is concerned with the one muscle is known as superior oblique muscle. Next, fifth nerve, trigeminal, consists of two things. One is sensory, another thing, motor part. Next, sixth nerve consists of your lateral rectus muscles will be a supply. Seventh, as you know, facial expression. Eighth is concerned with it of vestibular cochlea, vestibular part for hearing, and cochlear for balance. Cochlear part for balance. Ninth, glossopharyngeal, sensory. They are having sensory also, motor also, and special sensory also. Special sensory sometimes it will be causing taste sensation there. Next, 10th is concerned with it of your hollow organ testing, hollow organ supplying. 11th, spinal accessory is going to go for sternomedullomastoid and trapezius muscle supply. 12th nerve is going to go for motor supply of tongue muscles especially. So this is the thing what we are going to examine for cranial nerve. So when we are going to test this part, that indicates that that cranial nerve is going to be of normal or what. So coming on to the first cranial nerve, I told you, olfactory nerve. So this is the rough outline of olfactory nerve, where it starts from the frontal lobe down, where it is having olfactory bulb. From the olfactory bulb, it pierces the cribriform plate of ethmoid. This part is important here. So cribriform plate of ethmoid is going to be important here. Another thing, that filament will be there. Then it is going to be of supplying your nasal mucosa. This is the rough outline. So any abnormality in the olfactory nerve, I gave you that coffee powder previously. So coffee powder, jasmine, or any smell when you are going to give to smell to the patient, so that will be identified. So we are having two olfactory nerves, one on right side and left side. So each and every side will must, each nerve must want to test it separately by giving strong smells like things to be avoided, to avoid irritation of your nasal mucosa. That's all. So as I told you, frontal lobe, olfactory bulb, olfactory tract, cribriform front plate of ethmoid, and filaments. So any abnormality in this, anything can cause abnormality in the smell. So one is the thing, any problem in the frontal lobe or tumor or any affection in the frontal lobe or space accumulation can alter your smell. Second, alteration in the olfactory bulb, especially of cribriform plate of ethmoid, when this is going to be having or any fracture or injury, that will be injuring your nerve, that will be causing. Then along with that, common cold or nasal polyp or any abnormality in the nasal cavity as such can reduce your smell. So these are the general outline to identify abnormality in the olfactory nerve. Anosmia. Anosmia is nothing but absence of smell. So it may be of unilateral or bilateral. So unilateral means one side, bilateral means by two sides. So when unilateral hemangioma, meningioma is nothing but from subfrontal meningioma. So subfrontal part of meninges, when this is going to be a causing of any tumor there, it can affect unilateral one nerve, or it can affect two nerves also. According to that, we will be having anosmia, complete loss of smell. Next, bilateral or permanent bilateral anosmia, I told you, head injury affecting the cribriform plate. I told you previously here, cribriform plate is going to be important where all the fibers are exiting there. So anything is going to be of involving that cribriform plate can cause injury to the ear, full nerve, and it can able to cause complete anosmia. Next, neurodegenerative. So neurodegenerative, I don't told you, again Parkinson's disease concerned with it of trias, rigid tremor, and bradykinesia. Along with that one, Lewy bodies will be present there. So that, due to that, patient will be having loss of smell. Here, last, Kallmann syndrome, one syndrome is there. What is syndrome? Collection of group of symptoms when we are going to put for one name, that we are going to tell syndrome. So Kallmann syndrome is going to be one syndrome consists of group of symptoms which constitute that syndrome. So hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism along with impaired loss of smell, we can tell that is due to Kallmann syndrome. So patient is having hypogonadism symptom along with their patient is having loss of smell, we can suspect this may be of due to Kallmann syndrome. That is the clinical importance of anosmia here. So this completes your first nerve. Coming on to the second nerve here. So second nerve is important because second nerve is concerned with of vision. So we are having three components. First component is visual acuity. Second component is field of vision. Third is color vision. So visual acuity, as I told you, visual acuity is nothing but, so we want to identify some structures there. When patient can able to identify that, so it is that his acuity is normal. So example, books, phones, or paper weights, or anything, pen. When patient can, you show pen in front of patient, and patient is identifying that this is pen, this outline is going to be a mark, that indicates that patient is normal. When patient cannot able to identify, that indicates problem in the optic nerve, visual acuity. Next, we must want to cover each and every eye. We must want to do, because we are having two optic nerves, right eye must want to examine separately, left eye must want to examine separately. So two eyes must want to examine separately to identify abnormality for each nerve. Next, Snell chart, I'll tell you. So then glasses to be wear on. While testing of optic nerve, one important thing is that don't remove your glasses, because that may give you false reading due to refractive errors. In patients having refractive errors, due to refractory errors, patient cannot be able to read. You will be mistaking that. That is due to your optic nerve abnormality. So optic nerve abnormality as such will not affect due to refractory errors there. So this is the importance of Snell chart here. So here you see there are some numbers given sideways. 6 by 60, 6 by 36, 6 by 24, 6 by 18, 6 by 12, 6 by 9, 6 by 6, 6 by 5. So here we are telling that 6 by 6 is normal. So 6 by 6 is nothing but metric. So by 6 meter distance, patient can able to see, that is known as 6 by 6. So 6 meter distance, which normal patient able to see is going to be of your above. Normal patient, what you are going to see is known as below. What you are seeing is known as above. So first you think of patient when 6 by 60 is that 60 indicates normal patient. 6 is that your patient's thing. So when patient is seeing, normal patient is seeing by 60 meters, when this patient stays, want to go by 6 meters and see is that abnormality. Same like that, normal person can see from 36 meters, this patient can see by 6 meters alone. So this is the basic principle of your Snell chart. So 6 by 6 is that when patient is sitting normally by 6 meters, normal person also can able to see by 6. This is the thing of marking here. This is the clinical importance of Snell chart where we want to go for refractory errors correction here. See here, down normal visual acuity is known as 6 by 6. 6 by 60 means patient can see at 6 meters what someone will be standing from 60 meters and see here. Next, coming on to the optic diseases. Optic diseases may allude to optic. We want to have terminologies like optic nerve and optic tract. I'll tell you. So optic nerve disease may lead to degree of acute loss. So optic nerve consists of, so in case of each nerve, we are having medial part, lateral part. So medial part, we are telling that is known as nasal part. Lateral part, we are going now telling that temporal part. So temporal field or lateral field, medial field or nasal field. When both is going to be of normal. When both is going to be of unilaterally affected, patient will go for loss of acuity or complete blindness. So severe loss of acuity, as along with that of your Snell chart, they are telling that less than patient as having 60 bar 60. So that is the thing of first A. When patient cannot able to read, that A will indicate that patient will be having severe acute of vision. So first we want to check with it of this Snell chart. Then we must want to show from 1 meter, count the fingers, patient cannot able to do. Another thing, patient cannot able to persevere hand movements and perception of light only patient is going to be having. We can think that these are the important symptoms of your loss of acuity in case.